We now have the masterclass on writing and direction, and we are very honored and privileged to have amongst us one of Croatia's renowned directors, Rajko Grlić. Like all of you, clap your hands and welcome him on stage. In our midst, we are also happy to have another renowned director, Mr. Shivendra Singh Dungarpur. May I request you to kindly come on stage. Clap your hands, everyone. Mr. Dungarpur is a filmmaker, film archivist, director of the award-winning film Celluloid Man. And ladies and gentlemen, we have Mr. Ram Sahai Yadav to kindly give away a token of appreciation on behalf of us. Keep those hands clapping, ladies and gentlemen.
Wow, thank you very much. Thank you.
And one for Mr. Shivendra. Keep those hands clapping, everyone. Thank you. And ladies and gentlemen, may I request all of you to kindly turn off your cell phones. We now have Mr. Shivendra Dungarpur to say a few words. Welcome, sir.
Good morning, good afternoon, I think it's already past. Thank you for this opportunity to introduce one of the greatest legends of cinema. I don't know how many of you are aware of cinema from the great Yugoslavian past. I had the opportunity of during the making of my documentary, which I've been making on the Czech New Wave for the last 8 years, I've been spending time in Prague, and I was fortunate to meet at least 50 such filmmakers, some alive, some who had passed away, but I met them through their films. And then I realized that there was a whole group of Yugoslavian filmmakers who had studied at the great film school called FABU. And when I went to meet Emir Kustrika, you know, when on a set of his last film, I found Lordan Zafranovic, who's here at the festival as the jury member. And through Lordan, I was introduced to Rajko Grlić, one of the great filmmakers from Croatia. We're going to be seeing his film on the 23rd at 11 o'clock, his new film, Constitution. But Rajko is a very multifaceted filmmaker. He's an award-winning documentary filmmaker. He's made 12 feature films. He teaches at the Ohio University, Athens, not Athens in Greece, but Athens in Ohio. He also runs a very enterprising film festival called Motovan. I think we are really privileged and honored to not only for him to take us through his screenplay and direction class, but also talk about his own new film. But I think if he can touch upon the famous Prague Film School, which you know, generations of great film students have come out. His classmates itself, from Agnieszka Holland to Emir Kustrika to, you know, you can just name some of the greatest filmmakers who came out of FABU. I now request Rajko to take us through his class. Thank you, Rajko, and thank you, and welcome to Goa, welcome to India. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I have one.
Okay.
You can hear me properly, yes. So my name is Rajko Grlić. I'm coming from south of Europe. Used to be a country called Yugoslavia. Now it's Croatia. I'm making films. I started when I was 14 years old. I made my first feature when I was 25. I just finished and released in Montreal my last feature a month ago. So I'm still making films. That's what I'm making all my life. So what I will try when I was asked to talk a little bit about script writing, I wrote and co-wrote all my films. I also wrote script for 6-7 feature films other directors made. So I have little experience, but I will not even try to sell you any kind of recipe. I don't believe that exist the rules in the film. I think that every and each film is separate story and separate set of rules. So what I will do today is, and I have 1 hour, I'll try at the very beginning to take you on the journey which I passed with my last film. The film, the name is Constitution. In English, Croatian version is Croatian Constitution, because it's referred to Croatian Constitution. It's a low-budget film. We did it. We have 8 weeks to shoot, which is very rare for a low-budget film. We did it in Zagreb. It's the capital of Croatia. But to go back, we started with the project 3 years before we started. Last 4 films I co-wrote with young Croatian writer. Each of his book was at the top of best-selling books. He writes some funny, some not so funny books, but he's a very popular writer. He's much younger than I am. We are completely different characters, and that's probably the reason why for last 12 years we can sit from time to time in the room and together write the script. And we are still enjoying. So this script, and I have here because it was published as a book, and it was 2 months in Croatia, even as a script, best-selling book, which we were very proud. The whole story started, he was in Croatia, I was in America, and he sent me from time to time email, and I'm sending to him with some different ideas, some character, some line. We hear someone talking about some, or we find in newspapers. So almost on the weekly basis, we are exchanging some kind of ideas. And then the other one is just killing, saying, no, no, it doesn't make sense. Forget. So one morning, I got from him a short email saying it was very hot. He's living on the coast. I didn't sleep well. So I was thinking about one, my neighbor, who is old guy. He's a gay. And some kids beat him on the street. And the neighbor, the lady who is living nearby, helped him to come home. That was the whole thing, probably 5 lines. Small, short idea. 2 days later, I sent him email saying, what if they're living in the same building? What if the old man, gay, is professor of the history, who is living with his father, who is old fascist, who is now 91 and can't move, and he lives in one bed. And what if she have a husband who is different nationality, who is Serb, and they are living in the basement? So what if we start to play with those 4 characters? We didn't have any kind of story. We didn't have anything else. We just have 4 characters. We spent probably, then we sit together in Croatia and we start to talk. We usually sit in the car and we travel around, talking. And what we are basically talking, we are trying to remind ourselves of every possible character who can be close to one of those 4 characters. Do you remember this and do you remember that and so on? So little by little, we are building characters. We are not even talking about any kind of story. We believe, and that's how we work on last 2 features, that if we build characters, something is wrong. If you build characters enough strong, then we can start to play the game with them. Then we can start to tell the story. Normally, from the very beginning, we have in mind what the film and where we will place the film, what's the basic problem of the film. And we found, in the case of this film, there's intolerance. I'm living in the country which passed in the last 75 years two huge wars. And basically, the both wars were, with different reason and different influences, war between Serbs and Croats. Serbs and Croats, two nations, find themselves. They are speaking the same language. They are very close. They have different religion. But they found in both worlds themselves on the different sides. So 25 years after the war, the level of intolerance is still high. So we decide to talk about. That will be some kind of theme where we are going. But we are now first dealing with characters. So I think that we spent almost half a year just building those four, trying to find everything possible, trying to find how from basic idea to build someone who is three-dimensional human being, who have weakness and quality, who is good and bad, and so on and so on. And when you are doing this, then you are pushing your characters very far on the edge. You try to see how far they can go, how dark they can be, how funny they can be. But you are playing on the edges to see, because if they are different enough, then the dialogue is possible or intolerance is possible. But they need to be four very different characters. So we build the characters. My partner in crime is saying that we build the characters and then we throw them in the hole, and then we are trying to build the story, and with the help of story we are taking them out of this dark hole. So that's what we start to do. We start to do play game, which is basically if game. What if he needs to do this? What if he? And that's how I heard that every policeman in my country needs to pass exam in national constitution. And if one, and this policeman is a Serb, if the professor of history is big nationalist Croat, what if they were thrown in situation that they need to help each other, and professor hate this guy, but he needs to help him because his wife is doing favor to him. So what if they are thrown in situation that they need to be together on the base of this constitution? So that's how, under this if, we start to build the story. So after few times sitting 3-4 days in my studio in Zagreb, we are still not putting on the paper any kind of idea. We're just talking, but it's coming somehow little by little together. And then you're doing something which I like to do very much, and I think it's helping me to write, is you are pitching your story around. It's not this classical pitch to producer when you have 3 minutes to explain which kind of film you want when you're basically trying to sell your story. This is a pitch where you are telling the story to friends, sometimes even to unknown people. You are trying to find out their reaction on the story. And I found that this is helping me a lot, because not what they are saying, I like the story, or I don't like this character, but the way how they are listening, you can read everything about your story. If they start to lose the interest in one part, then this part is something is wrong with probably this part. If this character is something, he's not someone who they want to hear about, then you need to rebuild this character stronger. So dealing with this and pitching is a process which from then on until the final script, you are trying to tell and to see reaction. It's much better than on paper because you can tell your story in 2-3 minutes and you can see reaction immediately, how it works, if it works, why it's not working. So this is first step. That's how you are building story. Then when you have illusion that you have beginning, middle, and the end, that you foggily, you have some idea from where you are taking your characters, through what, and what is the end of such a story, then we start to write for the first time. Sometimes it's 2-3 pages as a first sketch. But in case of this film, was very soon, first version was like 15 pages. After spending almost a year building characters, trying to find the path of the story, we were under the illusion that we know from where and how we are going. So we end up, we spend a week in one room with 2 computers. We divide who is doing what. And we end up after a week with 30 pages, some kind of synopsis. Before the normal steps will be that you have story on half a page, you have story on 2-3 pages, and then you are doing, you are breaking the story in step outlines, scene by scene, to see first time how it worked. But this time, we didn't do it regularly. We jumped to the synopsis, 30 pages, and with this synopsis, we basically went out to shop for a producer. And I was lucky because one Croatian producer asked me last year if that he would like to make a film. I gave him, he said, yes, we'll make this. It's very easy to say, it's not so easy to make. In Europe, we are living by funds. You need to first got your government money. You go with 100 scripts to concourse, only 2-3 got the money. Then if you have your national money, then you're allowed to go to other European states to compete for their money. You need in Europe minimum to put 4 or 5 countries together to have something for decent low budget film. Low budget film is something between $1.5 million to $2.5 million. So we got producer and we start to play, and the first thing I did, I break the story now because it was written as a story almost, sometimes jumping, sometimes in the scenes, sometimes in the sequences, so it was not somehow organized properly what you need to have before you jump to the script. So I break in 140 scenes. I wrote about each scene a few lines and put on the wall. I like to have visually the whole structure of the film always in front of me through the whole process. So I can see, okay, here we are too long, here we need something. So you are writing on this wall, you're taking scenes out, you're putting new scenes in, but you are playing on the wall with some kind of general structure. Sometimes you even divide, like opening, ending, and the middle as a 3-part for one body. And that's the process that brings you to the first draft. First draft, it's something which you don't want to share with others. First draft is always full of different structural problems, full of big dialogues which you don't need at the end, and so on and so on. You are putting in the first draft everything. And first draft is more or less for yourself. You are writing for yourself. You want to see how those 120 pages are. And if you have 120 pages, if you have just 50 pages, or if it's 300 pages, you need to find out what you have as a story, and what's the length of the story, and what's the structure of the story. From then on, it's the same thing over and over. We write a new draft. We are writing on the base that usually we sit together, we lock and throw all phones and everything, and we are trying 2 weeks to live like in monastery. We are entering at 9 o'clock, we go for short lunch, and we are leaving around 6, 7. And sometimes we are just talking half a day because we can move. Sometimes you are blocked, sometimes it's not working, sometimes you write the same scene 7 times and it's still stupid. So you are trying, but the only way we found is not to talk about, is just to write. Write. Usually, this script was written in 7 drafts. It means that 7 times we spent 2 weeks in the same room writing 7 versions of the same script. And in the case of this film, we didn't restructure a lot. Structure was quite clear from the beginning. We just try to help our characters to behave like three-dimensional human beings. 7 drafts, we go with draft number 4 or 5, we start to shop for the money around, not before. You don't want to go out with a script which is not in your mind finished somehow. You can go just one to one producer or one fund, so you don't want to miss the opportunity saying, oh, it's not finished, it will be much better when we finish. So we start to shop. We start pre-production when draft number 6 was done. And I spent, we have 3 characters, main characters in the film. For 2, I knew from the very beginning who will play. 2 actors with whom I did films before. But the main character was unknown. I didn't find anyone who can really play. So I spent a year writing version 5 and 6, casting around, trying to find. I went through many fantastic actors, but they are not what I was looking for. So I finally found version 6 was done. And then what I'm doing month before shooting, I ask main actor to be 3, 4 of them to spend with me 2 weeks. And we are reading and we are improvising. We are playing with themes. We are trying to find the meaning. We are trying to find the language very often. We are changing dialogue, but then you find that for one actor, it's better this rhythm of dialogue. For another one, you need to adapt on different level. So basically, the last draft of the script is written after those rehearsals. So like Taylor, who is finally doing small changings that you look good. That's what we are doing with the script, to really fit every line to each actor and to everything what we need. Then you have script, you have actors, you have location, and then you start to direct, which is the best part of the film. So I try to take you to this very, I have half an hour more, but I will stop now with this story. It's a journey which I passed many times. And I must say that each time it's completely different. You're doing the same steps. You know what steps you need to do to come to the final script. I never did it in less than 2 years. I found that script is something like good wine. It basically needs time. Exist people who can write the script in 15 days and then they can shoot. It depends on the character of writers and directors. But my rhythm is something like 2 to 3 years for each script. I'm an extremely slow guy. So that's the story. And what I was thinking, that I didn't want to kill you with myself. So maybe I can give you, you are mostly film students. Raise the hand who is a film student. Oh, okay, majority, that's good. So I found that a lot of students, including myself and a lot of professionals, find that as novelists, we used to say that first line, blank paper and the first line, it's always the hardest thing. It's basically how to open the film. What to use and how to use the opening to establish the film. As you know, each film is completely different set of rules. And what is fantastic in the film, that you as writer and director is setting those rules. And you have, that's a different between cultures, basically. You have 5 minutes, you have 10 minutes, you have 15 minutes at the beginning of each film to give to the audience some kind of key to open the door to your story. You are telling them, that's the way how I will tell the film. I will tell you the story. Do you want to come with me on that journey? You are offering. You have 10 minutes. Otherwise, they are leaving the room. So what and how we are spending those first 10 minutes, what we are doing with the beginning of our stories. You know that this first impression is the most important. When you meet the girl or girl meet the boy, first few lines can take you on the long journey and can at the same time stop relations at that moment. So first impression, first thing. I'm coming from the culture, and I will show you the examples from the film, which are basically based on Aristotle, on the Greek and Western world idea, what the story and the structure of story is. Beginning, middle, and the end. Beginning is nothing before, everything after. Middle is the body of the story, and the end is everything before, nothing after. This is very classical Aristotle, which Hollywood translate to those million cookbooks about script writing. You can read, you can find in every bookstore, but this is based. I grow up in such a culture. I know that you are coming from a very different culture. So I'm trying to say what I will show you and present it's coming from this Western European idea about how we are telling the stories. Each culture is telling their stories completely different. I have some experience working with students from Africa, from Asia, from South America, and I found very early that I can push them to use this kind of structure I grew up with. I know how differently they are thinking about the stories, how they are using the time, what time means in their stories. So that's, I'm saying, is what I will try to show you. So I took examples, we'll not have time to go all of them.
Sunset Boulevard, Los Angeles, California. It's about 5 o'clock in the morning. That's the homicide squad, complete with detectives and newspapermen. A murder has been reported from one of those great big houses in the 10,000 block. You'll read about it in the late editions, I'm sure. You'll get it over your radio and see it on television. Because an old-time star is involved. One of the biggest. But before you hear it all distorted and blown out of proportion, before those Hollywood columnists get their hands on it, maybe you'd like to hear the facts, the whole truth. If so, you've come to the right party. You see, the body of a young man was found floating in the pool of her mansion, with 2 shots in his back and 1 in his stomach. Nobody important, really. Just a movie writer with a couple of B pictures to his credit. The poor dope. He always wanted a pool. Well, in the end, he got himself a pool. Only the price turned out to be a little high.
Okay. 50s are full of those films who are starting with voiceover. For many different reasons. As we said, always, we want to begin film with the story which happened in front of our eyes. We don't want to hear what happened before. We don't want to know what happened before, who were, and so on and so on. We want to eyewitness the story. So very often you have problem with the characters because before you start, you need to say something about them. You need to introduce their past, so that the audience can understand their present. In this case, it's voiceover, but not for such a reason. It's a teaser. We call it teaser, which means someone was killed. Do you want to hear who killed him and how the story happened? Okay, go with us on the journey. And that's how many, many films in 50s, from Billy Wilder to Mankiewicz, all about Eve, to Capra, to all those directors. They always have this kind of voiceover who is slowly introducing you and taking you on the journey. It's always a nice voice. It's always someone who wants to show you how beautiful the story will be. I'll go now with the president. I don't know if you know this film, but the man is not here anymore. He is making film about people who made this film. Something wrong?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I was surprised why it's not moving. Now it's fine?
Yeah.
Great. Let's start once again. Sorry.
On je hodnej,
veď? Strašne mlad.
Máš tu jeho fotku? A jaký on má oči?
No takový. Takový. Víš, ja ani neviem.
Tak počkaj. to musíš dát vejš, víš, on je od půl hlavy větší. Asi tak?
No tak. On to sluší. Co ty jsi mu dala?
Já ještě nic, to je pěkný vejš.
To je blbý. To mu musíš něco dát.
No jo, ale co?
Poslyšte, co nám to tady řešíte po stromech? To se nedělá. To nám to tady nemůžete takhle věšet. Vy jste nám tady opetlila celý les.
Já myslím, že se těm stromům snad nic nestane, ne?
No ale mohlo by se stát, že tady bude srnec, víte? A uvidí kravatu na stromě. Lekne se, už jste někde viděl, jak se lekne strana, co? No, tak on to dělá asi takhle, víte? Tak se leká, líbí se vám to? To bychom takhle jednou to bekání spolu mohli poslouchat, co říká? Co vy na to?
A on mi právě o těch zvířatech, víš, že třeba nežijou spolu jako pořád, jako lidi ty zvířata jenom jednou za rok. A to když je říká tak, víš, potom jsou zase svobodní a prostě žijou sami a nevážou se na sebe, nebo tak, víš, jako lidi. Akorát divoký husy, ty jsou jako lidi, víš.
Jo.
No. Oni žijou spolu až 120 let.
Jo.
To je vy. No a představ si, když on zastřelí třeba jeho, víš, nebo jí.
Tu husu, jo.
No, tak zůstane ten druhej sám třeba 100 let.
A co Tonda?
No, on... Když jsme šli pryč, tak jsme tam tu kravatu nechali a když jsme se vraceli, tak tam ještě visel, tak asi nepřišel.
Tak budeš chodit s tím dle.
Já nevím. On je totiž ženatej, víš.
Jo.
No dobře, pořád se nemůže zbavit toho dojmu, že ty lidi nám tady chybějí.
Ale ovšem,
že já mám důvod, má někde platce. Dá se, jestli si zvolí nějak vážně, tak si ho vezme, dají se a budou možná někam jinam. To uznáme jako důvod, ale nemůžeme uznávat důvody, že prostě už je tady potřetí a pokaždé říká, budu se vdávat, jo, a pořád se nevdávám. Tak já jsem proto nepouštětý zatím, až se vdá, tak teprve potom. My musíme každopádně furt mít na mysli to, že fabrika musí plnit plán.
Ale ano. Ale člověk tady musí žít, pro vás svatýho, ne?
To je problém. Podívejte, podíváme-li se na mapu, tak z našeho hlediska není účelné, aby jsme sem do tohoto prostoru dávali armádu, vojsko. My chápeme vaše důvody. A taktéž tyto úkoly a problémy máme u nás v armádě.
Vy máte svoje, my máme taky svoje.
Prosím. Nevím.
Tak u vás, prosím, tady je ta mapa. To je vaše stanovisko, ano? To je pro vás. Ovšem, vy nevíte, že tady v tomto prostředí žije 2000 děvčat. Děvčat, který nemají chlapce. U nás je na jednom chlapce 16 děvčat. Děvčat, to jsou poupata. Rozumíte mi? To je mládí, který potřebuje to, co jste potřeboval vy, slovo majore, i já a všichni ostatní, ano?
V mladých letech.
Tak, tak, to je ono, že ano. Tak vy máte svoje stanovisko, vy máte jenom mapu a já mám celý ten život těch mladých lidí. Uvědomte si, když to děvče pracuje tady v tom závodě těch 8 hodin u té mašiny, teď vyjde z té fabriky, tak co, nají se, že ano? Teď nemá nikdo, nikoho, kdo by i pohladil, kdo by jí políbil. Teď si uvědomte, kdyby tak ta válka nebyla 50 let. Nebyla. Už všichni bojujeme, i vy s Romanou bojujete, že ano? Kdyby nebyla. No, no a když ta válka nebude 100 let?
No já vám na to můžu jenom odpovědět.
No,
já jsem neřekl konečné, závěrečné slovo.
No,
já tento váš návrh mohu jedině tlumočit dál. Budeme vidět, co se nechá dělat.
No, dál. Kdo to je dál? Co to je dál?
Okay, I'll stop. I'm just trying to show you how in American film, Billy Wilder, the whole beginning needs 2.5 minutes, and they are in the story. In Europe, we have all the time in the world. Our beginnings are 15 minutes. We have problem to introduce our characters because no one knows them. When you see American actor as a policeman in New York on the street at 3 o'clock in the morning, you know all about him because you saw 300 films about. When we are introducing from small countries our characters, we need huge amount of time to say who they are, what they wish to do, where they are going, and so on. So this is just example of two cultures and two openings. At the same time, this film is driven by the characters. So what Forman and Passer, the man who wrote the script, is the head of jury today on your festival, one of fantastic directors who, in my opinion, did the best Czech movie ever. And he wrote a lot of Forman films and co-wrote with Forman a lot of films. They know that this is not a big story. This is not something, no one will die, no one will be killed. It's just a story about the girls who are desperately trying to find someone. So he's starting with a dream with the girl, with some kind of portrait who she is. That's usually films which are driven by the characters, not by the story or plot, are starting on such a way. I have 5 more minutes, and each example which I prepare, it's much longer. So I think it's better to stop now. Maybe one day somewhere we can talk about these openings and other stuff. But now I think it's a time for your questions. Those are clips which I prepare, which I think are explaining different ways of starting a film. All the way to Terrence Malick, who is starting the film on a very strange way, through all those films. And just to give you one more paper which I prepare. Are we done with photo session? Okay, and this is just small recommendation. Aristotle Poetics, that's the basic book of Western civilization and storytelling. So if you have interest, it's not easy to read, but that is all about in. Umberto Eco, Italian writers, he's dealing with the story and the fiction on completely different way and very smart way. Jean-Claude Carrier is probably the best what Europe ever have as a scriptwriter. He wrote a lot of Buñuel's film. He wrote for Peter Brook and so on. He was running the French film school. That's a book about the pain, how painful it is to write the script. All American books about script writing are about the joy of writing. French version is how painful it is to write. And the last one is Louis Hunter. It's the man who was running UCLA and 80s, 90s majority of scriptwriters of all big blockbusters American came from his school. Book exists. I call all those books cookbooks, scriptwriting cookbooks, and this is the best of all those. That's the book where you can find what you need to have on page 7, where you need to finish character opening until page 12. It's everything all full with million rules, but it's very helpful to go once through the book and see how this translation of Aristotle in Hollywood works. So those are, that's it.
Yeah.
Showed the different openings.
I think we have. We'll leave it at that, and then we can.
Because we will lose the time to.
We just leave it at that opening.
Here, this.
No, they were talking about the opening of the film. This one.
Ah, this one. Okay. Yeah. Yes, we can leave the open. Yeah. Okay. Yes, that's it.
Yeah, he'll do it after that. All right, thank you very much for this wonderful session, Rajko. I'm sure it was useful to a lot of people who want to write their own scripts or get writers to write. Wonderful to see Loves of a Blonde and many other films of Forman. Really, truly, I mean, those are the films which Passer says, banal films, which that's what the communists said. Nothing really happens. And I think that's the essence of what, to me, is screenplay writing, because where nothing really happens which you perceive, but it's so much true to real life, what really happens between us. And some of the Czech new films, if you get the chance to see it, do not miss intimate lighting.
It's playing here?
It's playing here. The restored version is going to be playing here.
It's a fantastic film.
It is one of the best Czech films, I think, ever made. And Ivan Passer is the jury head, so you must watch that. Don't miss that. And Lauren Zafranovich's 26 Pictures was also playing, which is on 35mm.
Will the character drive the plot, or plot drives the character? Plot navigates the characters.
Ooh, that's a three-hour discussion.
One more.
It's not so simple to answer in one question. I believe that the character is driving the plot. I think that the character is the beginning and the end of every story. A plot is something which is basically a vehicle for a character. It's a car in which characters sit and drives. But the character is who is driving the story, not the car. So I will go with the first version.
I have two questions, actually.
He's just asking. Just 1 minute. After that.
Here, Rajko. Hey, Shivendra. Rajko, I had a simple question. Do you get chance to watch Indian commercial movies, and which one do you like, if any?
Which movies?
No,
Indian movies.
Have you watched any Indian films?
Yes, but I'm not brave enough to remind you of the titles. From Ray, from this trilogy, which everyone knows, and we were, as a kid in the school, like shown from that time. Yes, I saw, I don't remember the names of the directors. I saw probably 20, 30, no more.
Any new movies?
No. I was selecting for 10, I started the festival, which still exists, but I retired because I'm too old to run. And for 10 years, I was selecting the films. So at that time, I was watching 300 to 400 films.
Which new movie do you want him to watch?
Give me a list.
Yeah.
No. Not recent Indian films. No.
Yeah, sure.
So from the example you have given about you guys came up with a concept about a professor who was a gay and there is a lady who helps him. So once you got the characters, how did you come up with the genre or the way of the movie, how the narration has to be? Like, how did you fix upon the genre with these characters?
I believe that when you're starting to make some kind of plot, when you are starting to use characters and you put them in the car and you go on the journey, which is the story, that's a huge freedom. You don't need necessarily to select the genre. It will happen on the way. You are not using the formula. It needs to be comedy, and now we will try that every step on the way will be funny. It depends on the character. Here, in the case, our case, characters. I'm trying to develop such a strong character who can tell me, basically, no, don't touch me. Don't push me there. I want to go there. That's kind of characters you want to develop. But in the case of this film, because my partner is someone who is writing comedy quite often, and he is somehow always going there. I'm a darker person, as he likes to say, and I'm going to other side. So it's always battle. And in this case, I think that first version was much funnier, much more comedy oriented, but never comedy. We didn't have from beginning intention to do the comedy because we try something different. I try to have the serious film which you can watch with little smile on the face. So that's a very hard to explain what genre it is. It's a real heavy story, so it's a drama, it's not a comedy. But if you can mix in enough, and that's probably what Central Europe, the whole culture in which I grew up, is that they have so many tragedies in life. The war is happening very often there and ruining everything. So we established something with Germans called Galgen humor. It's basically you're dying, but you are laughing. You know, and the laugh is what in Czech cinema, in our cinema, the laugh is some kind of sign that you are still alive. And you are telling the tragic story because you live those stories. But you want to tell them with the laughs. So it's not comedy. Genres exist in American film, basically. That's the industry which needs to have exactly clear November 2018 in 3,000 cinema from 2 will play comedy. They don't know the title, they don't know who will direct, but they need comedy here because that's the structure, how they're structuring the screen and distribution. So they need exactly for each genre name, and this is industry. We are making, in my country and all over the Europe, so-called handmade films. We are not part of the big industry. You have industry with 2,000 films. That's what I call industry. But when you're making in small countries, you know, we are smaller than a few of your towns. We are 4.5 million people lives in my country. In my neighbor country, it's 1.5 million lives. So this is not enough for a decent town. So, and we are different culture. So that's our defense.
Hi, Vicky here. One thing that you said about structure, when you're working on the structure, on the board that you said, is it typically index cards you're talking about? Because you go through various structures, like you discussed, like sometimes it's orthodox, sometimes it's Hollywood, sometimes it's the way you see a long time it takes to introduce the characters. So what is the structure you're talking about? Is it mostly through index cards?
No, but it's coming from probably the I once did CD-ROM How to Make Your Movie, which was interactive game.
Okay.
And to write something which is not linear, you need the cards. And you need the cards of different colors. So in the room like this, I have cards all over. But when I'm writing script, it's basically linear story. And it's not cards. It's on each paper, you can fit 10 scenes. So it's 14 papers on the wall.
So you do it on the wall with
on the wall,
papers?
Scene number one, number two, number three, number four, and then you cross those three scenes and put two here, or you take these two scenes there, and you are playing the magic structure on the wall.
Yeah, and that's
not card. Okay. Card will be probably easier, but I never did with a card.
And that's before the first draft?
Before, when you are first time breaking the story in the scenes, which is probably in the script writing process the hardest things to do. You have a story, Joe and Maria loves each other, but then came the father and say no, no marriage, and the story starts. Everything is fine, but how you will break in the scenes, something which is easy to say or easy to write. This is step outline. This is a base for me for every film. Breaking after each draft, I break again the whole story on, and put on the wall as a structure.
So it's basically the script put
script
on the wall.
Script on the wall.
Yeah, after every draft. Yeah.
For each scene, it's just one sentence. No more than one sentence so that you can read easily, visually.
So it's like a small line from the draft.
It's saying number, exterior, Joe's room, day.
Okay.
You have basic information, this headline, and then you have Joe sitting in his room and he's reading the Bible.
Yeah, and another important thing that you said, like before shooting, when you have your actors with you, like for 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. So that also helps in the blocking. Like, you know, you might miss a great moment when you're starting shooting, but when you're spending time with them.
Yes, but you don't insist on blocking too much. It's more about the language, the dialogue. You took the scene which is written and you say, okay, if you just use this line, what can happen with this? So you are improvising. I'm always shooting with a few small cameras, so that say you remember that it was some good line there. So you go back and find this line and wrote in the script as a better line than what you already had.
Blocking, I think you've asked enough questions. I think you can meet him personally. He's here for the festival.
Blocking
the
is
back,
okay.
Anyone at the back? because we haven't had hands up. I mean, anyone at the back? Yeah, just get the mic at the back, please. If there's any questions. Raiko is here for the 2 days. I mean, you can catch up with him.
He will not talk to this.
At what stage you will design the sounds and tell something about music? How will you fix the music director and the theme of the music?
Music is always for me one of the hardest part. Because I know the rules. I always have intention to have the music before or basic theme before I even start to shoot. That's idea. That's something which I would like. Sometimes happened, sometimes not. But music is usually coming at the end of the story. When you start, we are editing film as I'm shooting, my editor is putting film together. So I'm just marking him, take 3, take 7. So he's using what I mark and he's putting the scenes together, just the base to see how it works. So we have first cut 2 days after I finish And then we spend another 3 months editing. Immediately from the beginning, you would like to have some music in the film. So usually what music editor is doing, I work on the last film with the lady from New York, one of the leading ladies, who Morricone don't want to record without her, and so on and so on. So what she's doing, and she's a music editor of the film, she's bringing million different CDs and musics which she thinks can fit to this type of the scene or character or whatever. So she's every 5-6 days offering you something. And then you listen and say, no, we will go in different direction. So little by little through the editing process, she is throwing things, and little by little you are focusing what can fit, what can live with the picture. It's very strange how in editing room you put fantastic music, you are sure it will work. Music and image start to run and they don't like each other very often. And you are surprised. You don't know why. They are just going different routes and you can use the music. When you finally came to something, then she will start to give you ideas who can write this type of the music. Then the next step will be you are talking for days with different composers, you are listening, you are at home alone, you try to find what's the sound. Because once the sound is there, that's the sound of your film. That's forever. It's like two basic, it's selecting the actors and selecting the sound. That's what you have. So it's always painful. Two or three times, in the middle of the process, I start with one composer, I say thank you, and I start with another one in the middle of editing process. It's very painful, it's not fun, but you are trying to save and go with your film as far as you can. Then he will write some kind of demo. You will try to put on, and then in the editing room starts a huge discussion. No, we don't need this music. You basically, everyone is always asking for more music than finally you put in the film. And then it's starting this process that demo is 3 times better than the final big orchestra version, and you're using demo instead, what costs a lot of money, and so on and so on. But it's a long, long process, and finally, in the final mix, you are deciding what's going on, what's going out, and how loud you want music to play. I don't like this approach, cartoon, which American films more and more are doing, that with first frame music starts, with the last frame music ends. Where I did my thesis film in the school, I was sure that I will never use the music, that music is not fair to be used in films, so I did my thesis film without one, with any music. So it's different. Then now I'm using quite a lot. In the last film, I have a Macedonian composer who lives in New York, and he did the music, and I think that he did a very good job.
Let's have the last question. Anyone in the back? Right at the back there? Right at the back? There, the back at the back there. Yeah. One last question. We can just have a... Okay, all right.
Yeah. Sir, what would you expect from your cinematographer before the shoot and on the day of shoot?
I didn't understand, sorry.
Your question again?
What will you expect from your cinematographer before the shoot, that is the planning process, what should a cinematographer do in the planning process and on the shoot, on the day of shoot?
Okay. What I'm expecting from my DP is first to read all the versions of the script. I'm torturing him. then I'm expecting to walk through the possible location before we start or before we send anyone to scout for the location. Just that we can start to talk about what the image will be, what kind of image we need for the such a film. So I'm trying to involve him very early. I'm even asking him to be on with actors when I'm spending those 2 weeks, to be there 2-3 days, just to start to recognize them, just to start to find out what he can expect from them, how and when. And then what I'm doing, this is DP number 4, which I did the last film. I did with each DP 2, 3, sometimes 4 films, and then I'm trying to do with another one. I'm trying to avoid that you fall in some kind of cliche of collaboration, so I need fresh blood as old man. And I did this one with the guy for the first time. You first need to learn the language of the new person and DP. You spend a month or two to start to understand when he's saying something is good, what it really means, when he's just listening, not talking, what that, and so on and so on. You start to discover the person. And then we are sitting at the same table, and I am explaining him what I want from each scene. Thank you very much. No, it will be better without. I'm trying to say, okay, look, we are in this room. I will try to start the scene that he just stand up and then he move here, and I will try to draw. I'm drawing a lot. So I will use and say, okay, this character goes here and then goes here. I will start with this kind of close up, and let's have those two person at the end of the shot so that we can move. So basically, we are discussing how to shoot the scene. I found that it's necessary, like a month or 2 months before, to have idea about first 10 days of shooting. You need to find the proper language. Each film you're approaching differently. Each film needs a different way of telling the story. It needs different kind of shots, different kind of camera, moving camera, static camera, long shots, short shots, and so on and so on. So I'm trying with him to find as much as I can before we start to shoot. And we have, usually for this film, we have 15 for 2 weeks. We have exactly shot numbers, what kind of shot, and so on. I'm sitting every morning before I go to set. I wake up a little earlier, and I drew storyboard for myself. I never use this storyboard on the set, but I am coming to the set with some kind of feeling that I know what I need to do. And then what I'm doing with DP as the end of this story, we are. Yeah, 1 minute more and I'm done. At the beginning of each scene, I'm asking all the actors to be with me in the space where we will shoot. I'm asking everyone else to go out, and I'm trying to find with them proper mise-en-scene. We know more or less what needs to happen, but I have I learned that it's good with actors to give them this chance that they will find, if you say, sit down, and there are 3 chairs, to give him chance to sit where he wants. He will sit in the first, I need him in the third, so I need to spend some time moving them to the third and giving them illusion that he select the third one, not me. So basically, you are manipulating, you are trying to find what is the scene. Then when you have the scene, I'm calling, or he's already with me, and I'm saying, okay, we will shoot this. This is shot number 1. shot number two. Continuity person is writing all this. Shot number four, shot number seven. What do you think? He will say, I think that we don't need shot number four, that we can put those two together, fine. We make the shot list on the set, and then two of us are discussing with sound person order of the shots. We'll shoot first this, this, and then that. So he is involved from script to the final set. That's what I expect from this and DP.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. That's it, unfortunately.
Thank you.
Thank you, Daiko. Thank you, everyone, for coming. And hope all of you are there to see his film on 23rd at 11 o'clock. And you'll meet Daiko there, and I think you will have more questions to ask once you see the film. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.